Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's meeting of InForum, the hip young division of the Commonwealth Club, available online at commonwealthclub.org/inforum. I'm Peter Norvig, Director of Research at Google, and joining me tonight is Nicholas Carr. He's the author of the bestseller, The Big Switch, Rewiring the World from Edison to Google, as well as the infamous Atlantic article, Is Google Making Us Stupid?, and this month's noteworthy book, The Shallows, What the Internet is Doing to Our Brain. So, Nick, why don't you introduce us to the thesis of your book for the audience who may not have read it yet.
Okay. The subject of The Shallows, broadly speaking, is the way that the tools we use to think with, what I call our intellectual technologies, influence the way we think, and sometimes in very dramatic, even profound ways. And I think you can trace the course of that influence through the intellectual history of humankind, back to very, very early types of intellectual technologies, like the map, which suddenly replaced our purely sensory perception of the world around us with an abstract picture of that perception. And also, I think, by doing that, gave us a more abstract way of thinking in general. Similarly, the mechanical clock, by dividing what had been a natural flow of time into precisely measurable units, in addition to its practical uses, many practical uses, also gave us, influenced our intellectual development, gave us a more scientific mind, a mind more focused on measurement, and again, more looking more at the abstractions behind sensory experience. But the main focus of the book is two more recent and very, very important intellectual technologies. On the one hand, the book, which about 2,000 years old and only been popular really for 550 years, relatively short span in human history, after Gutenberg invented the printing press. And on the other hand, the internet, broadly defined, defined as basically digital networks that we use to find information, store information, communicate, and so forth. And I think I make the argument that these two technologies in particular have a very, very different effect on our minds in the way we think. The book did something extraordinary in human history by helping us, by training us to be very attentive, to focus on one thing, to shield ourselves from distractions, filter out those distractions, and hence gave us a more attentive mind, I think. And the internet, in almost the opposite way, inundates us with distractions, inundates us with stimuli, and I believe is giving us a less attentive and ultimately less deep and thoughtful mind.
Okay, so isn't it true that every technology is cursed and also hailed as a panacea? You know, you mentioned books. James Barry, the author of Peter Pan, said that the printing press is either the greatest blessing or the greatest curse of modern times. I forget which. And Newton Minow said that when television is good, nothing is better, and when television is bad, nothing is worse. He said that in 1961, and of course, 3 years later, he was immortalized as the name of the boat on Gilligan's Island, which you can decide whether that's better or worse. This has always been the case for every new technology. How really is the internet different than other technologies?
Yes, I'm a part of a long and distinguished tradition, I have to tell you. I think if you look at it, it's certainly true that people have been skeptical and questioned every new technology that's come along, and some of those worries have proven unwarranted. Others, with TV, for instance, there's been a lot to say for those doubters. I mean, the human race didn't collapse on itself and the world didn't explode, but they did have effects that were often negative as well as the positive effects. I think what distinguishes the net from other recent technologies that have been questioned, two good examples, or at least one good example, is the calculator, for instance, that a lot of people thought if you let kids use calculators in school, they were never going to learn math, arithmetic, and that's been pretty much proven untrue, at least for talented math students. They actually were able to use that tool and get beyond kind of routine calculations to more abstract thinking. The difference between a tool like the calculator, even TV, which was segregated to a part of our life, a part of the time we are awake, is that the net in the tools of digital communication and digital information discovery are now with us all the time. Many people today, the first thing they do when they get up is you know, grab their iPhone or their BlackBerry, check email, and they're in a constant state of kind of digital distractedness, more or less, to the time they go to bed, when the last thing they do is check their email or check other messages. And so I think that unlike almost any other technology, or particularly information or communication technology, which had a segregated role in our life, the net has increasingly is there all the time and is influencing the way we think throughout our waking hours, basically, and even when people get up at 3 in the morning to check their email, even in the middle of the night.
But aren't other technologies just as pervasive? I mean, I can't walk down the street more than a couple steps without seeing billboards and other types of writing. So that certainly changed the way we see the whole world because we know how to read and write. How is having this available online making it different?
Well, because there are different types of reading. And, you know, one type of reading that we do all the time with billboards, with menus, with signs in stores and labels is a very skimming and scanning form of reading where you want to just get, you know, whatever the key content is as quickly as possible. It's not the way it's expressed or anything else is not important. It's just a utilitarian type of reading. But there's another very different type of reading, which is very immersive, very attentive. It's the kind of reading that for many people came after the book arrived. And you're not being constantly distracted. You're focused on this one thing. And the reading, I would argue, that most of us do most of the time, and some of us do all of the time, online, because the net is such a multimedia system and a system of messaging and distractions and interruptions, is more like the skimming and the scanning and the very utilitarian mode of reading that goes along with billboards and such. And it's rare that the net gives us any encouragement or opportunity to do deeper reading or deep attentive thinking in general.
Okay. Now, are you just saying that I miss my old reading? You know, I remember there was an Onion article that said scientists have proved that the best movies and music ever were those that were made when you, the reader, were 16 years old. And every generation feels that. And, you know, you can go back in history. Hesiod in 700 BC said, "I see no hope for the future of our people if they are dependent on the frivolous youth of today." John Aldridge in 1970, when I guess television was the latest scourge, says, "The young are remarkable for their boundless appetite for banality, their disinterest in ideas, their inarticulateness and limpness of manner," and so on and so on. So every generation complains about kids these days. So I polled the chairs of the leading computer science departments because I figured if there's a pernicious effect of computer science technology, probably maybe the computer science students are going to be hit the worst. And Ed Lazowski, who's the chair at University of Washington, said, I asked him to compare students today from 20 or 30 years ago, he said, intellectually and in terms of their ability to reason, to create, and to communicate, students are better than ever. Today's graduate students arrive with research accomplishments that look like the tenure cases of 20 years ago. Kids these days are facile communicators in ways that adults simply don't understand. And the chairs at CMU and Stanford and Berkeley more or less agree. Interestingly, MIT says that their students were always excellent and they still are. So. So it seems like what Ed's saying here is that, yeah, students are different, but they're different in a way that is giving them new powers.
Well, first of all, I don't see this in generational terms. I mean, my argument isn't, oh, kids these days are, you know, going to hell, which, you know, is what my parents said about kids those days when I was a kid. I think, in fact, that this mode of thinking and this mode of interaction influences all of us. And in fact, if you look at statistics, you know, web use goes up, you know, after you get out of your teens, in your 20s, your 30s, your 40s, when you go to work and the expectation becomes that you're always online, you're always looking at screens, when your social sphere expands and you keep in touch through Facebook, through texting. And so forth. So I don't see this as a, you know, as a generational complaint. And I think a lot of parents who think the problem lies with their kids should look at their own behavior and in their own attachment to their devices. As far as you know, what the quality of artificial intelligence students coming into schools, I can't comment on that. I don't know. But I think you'll find, if, for instance, you went to many other professors, many other educators, even at younger grades, they would paint you a very different picture of kids who come in and aren't very articulate, can't form sentences, have trouble paying attention, are constantly distracted. So what you might be describing is a shift in ways of thought toward the ways of thought that are more conducive or support people who go into artificial intelligence, and I'm just speculating here, I don't know, but maybe hamper other people.
One of the studies you cite that struck me was by Ziming Liu, who looked at well-educated, successful professionals, and they all said they're doing less in-depth reading than they were a decade ago. And it struck me that this is not a generational thing, but it's a career thing. And, you know, certainly when I was in graduate school, I was deep reading focused on just one thing. But now I've got 30 different projects I have to look at. And, you know, it really pains me sometimes to say, you know what, I'm listening to a report on this project and I don't really understand it in depth because I got 30 other things to worry about. But doesn't that happen to everybody as they sort of rise in responsibility?
I think the general tendency is for distractions to increase as you get older, you get a career, you get a family, you're juggling more things. But that, if anything, that means the penalties of having this media that are constantly adding additional distractions and additional streams of information and flows of information actually are all the worse. So the fact that we've always been distracted doesn't mean that therefore, we can be a whole lot more distracted, and it won't make any difference.
Mm-hmm. Okay, could you outline exactly what are the distractions? I mean, is it that it's paper versus a screen? Is it hyperlinks versus not hyperlinks? What are the real culprits?
I think it's the basic nature, the basic characteristics of the net as a medium that you have hypertext. Which by definition exists to, and this is the great, these are all, by the way, also the great strengths of the net as a medium, but I think they also promote distractedness. There's hypertext with, you know, large amounts of links that, on the one hand, if we click on them, we're taken away, and we've all had the experience of like clicking and clicking and clicking and then not knowing where we began. But there's also a subtler effect of links that every time we come across one, our frontal cortex, which is our decision-making part of our brain, has to pause for a moment and say, should I click on this or not? And that's a little distraction. There's the multimedia nature of the web. It's, you know, I think clearly the most intensive mix of media that we've ever seen in the past. It not only has audio and video and images, but for the first time, it's a broadcasting medium that can accept a whole lot of text. So there's a whole lot of stuff typically going on at once. It's also a great interruption system. It's feeding us messages, alerts, RSS notices, tweets, Facebook updates all the time. And again, that's one of its powers as a medium, but it's also very distracting. And finally, and due to many of those, it's encouraging a constant multitasking, constant juggling of visual stimuli as well as actual jobs. So I think it's all of those things combined.
Okay. Now, one of the things that struck me, you cite Marianne Wolfe, who's an expert in this area, and she says the web returns us to the time of scriptura continua, which is the ancient like Latin script where there are no spaces in between words, and supposedly it's an additional cognitive task to have to separate that out into spaces. And so deciding not to click on a link is this additional cognitive load. Now, ironically, that paragraph had a footnote at the end of it. And looking up that footnote took me about 20 to 30 times longer than it would have taken if I had had that book online, and really got me out of the flow, and I felt very distracted. And I also wanted to say that from what I know of the task of word segmentation, it's really not all that difficult. That Chinese and Japanese don't have spaces between the words. They have no problem doing that. I have a little example on for my textbook where I have a 10-line program that does word segmentation with 99% accuracy. So that's not really so bad. And maybe hyperlinks aren't so bad either. Maybe it's that we have to train ourselves that...
You're saying having no spaces between words wasn't bad?
Yeah. Let
me correct one thing. It wasn't Marianne Wolfe who said that.
No,
it was actually
right.
Me. Okay. So I don't want her... Don't blame her if that was ridiculous.
Excuse us, Marianne.
But she did say that she worries that the kind of intensive decision-making and problem-solving that now goes along with reading in a hypertext multimedia environment could return us more to our decoding method of reading and steal away our ability to make deep interpretation of text. But no, I think actually that's incorrect about having no spaces between words. I mean, and this is going to get a little bit esoteric, but up until 1,000 years ago, there were no spaces in most languages between words. And also, there was no silent reading. And the reason there was no silent reading is because it was really hard to figure out where one word ended and one began, and so you had to read it out loud. And it was only after, so it was a very cognitive, I think it was a very cognitive stress, cognitively intense process. And it was only after you had spaces that you saw the emergence of silent reading and the kind of personal reading and deep reading that went along with it. So I think that shows us that if... you return a lot of a cognitive juggling to the act of reading, and whether it's just your frontal cortex flashing for a second to figure out whether to click a link or whether it's you have, ads running down the side of a column or all sorts of other things, you are kind of overloading our short-term memory, which has a very small capacity, and you're making it much harder to comprehend the reading, understand it at a deep level, and make all the interpretive leaps and jumps that give deep reading, I think, its richness.
So you're saying that Chinese and Japanese people can't do deep reading?
I think they can. You're talking there about a completely different alphabet. And it is true, actually, that studies show that it is more cognitively intense simply because of the huge number of letters. So reading is different in those languages. The act of reading is cognitively different in those readings, with those languages than it is with English. And there's even differences between, like, English and Italian because of the way the words either match up with the way you pronounce them or not. So any kind of even small changes in language or the way words are presented, I think, does have cognitive implications.
Yeah, so I guess that was one of the things that always struck me is that throughout the book, I think you do an excellent job of talking about the plasticity of mind, to say that this theory that we're kind of born with what we have and that's it is not proving to be true, that we do change all the time, that the technologies we deal with change us, that our experiences change us, and our mind is always growing and altering. But some of the places, it seems like, it's just sort of too much kind of scare quotes, you know. So you quote Mersenich, who uses all caps to say, heavy use of the internet has neurological consequences. And geez, that sounds scary. But then you think about it and you say, well, what's the neurological consequences? It's that you know stuff. And maybe that's the neurological consequence that's not so bad, right? And it seems that that's what you're pointing out, is that you're always being changed, and we should think about which of the changes are positive and negative and how are we going to arrange it to push us in the right direction.
I completely agree with that, and the more we can push the technology and the way we use it in the direction to encourage attentiveness, I'm all in favor of. I think there are differences. It's absolutely true that all our experiences influence our brain. I mean, at the very baseline, we have to store memories or we lose memories or whatever. But what I think neuroscientists have found is that there are certain types of experiences that have particularly deep effects on our brain, and those particularly ones that are highly repetitive, are intensive, and kind of involve a lot of stimuli and a lot of physical activity and mental activity. And it's precisely the kind of thing we do when we're sitting at our computers. I mean, we're constantly repeating physical actions, clicking and or scrolling or you know, using the touch screen on our iPhone or iPad or whatever, and we're constantly getting signals and alerts and messages that we respond to in particular ways. So it's a very intensive way of training our minds in, I think, a particular way of thinking. And I think what's happening is we're reinforcing those mental functions and even down to those mental circuits that make us good at skimming and scanning. And there's been certainly studies that show our visual acuity improves as we use particularly video games. But there's no encouragement and there's no reward for the more attentive modes of thought, for contemplation, for reflection, for introspection, for deep reading. And neuroscience also tells us that when we don't practice different ways of thinking, we begin to lose those, even down to the point that the circuits begin to weaken in our brain, if not eventually dissolve.
Yeah. So I agree with you that there's a temptation that you could easily spend your whole life playing Farmville or looking at pictures of kittens and never get anything useful done. But that's your choice. And you also have the option of doing this deep reading. And I don't see how deep reading is any way cut out by being online. And if anything, it's easier to get an entree into it. And one way to think about it is in game theory, there's this notion of a multi-armed bandit. Now, in Las Vegas, of course, we have the one-armed bandit. You go and you put your money in the slot, you pull it, and you either get a reward or you don't. In game theory, multi-armed bandits means there's lots of slot machines out there. And unlike Vegas, maybe some of them pay off positive results rather than negative. And your task, then, is to decide, well, which slot am I going to put the money in? And so there's two phases. There's this exploration phase when we say, you know, which slot machine is the good one? And then the exploitation stage when I say, you know, I found one that's pretty good. I'm going to stick with this. And I think that the trade-off between those two, which we always have, according to the percepts of game theory, is different on the web than it is in a library. You go to a library, you go to the shelf, there's four books on that shelf. It's pretty easy to say, you know what, this is the right shelf. This is the right book. I'm going to exploit that book, and I'm going to read it deeply. On the web, you go to the shelf, there's 40,000 results. You've got to spend more time in the exploration stage, and then after you've done more exploration, now you say, now I'm going to start reading deeply. So I think there's a shift in when that happens, but I don't see any reason why the deep reading is precluded.
Well, first of all, since we know that the vast majority of people just look at the first three Google results, I'm not even sure that there's all that much more exploration going on. But I mean, I think, and people can look at their own experience of their children, other people's experience, or can look at, you know, general societal trends. I don't think there is that. I totally agree with you that, you know, I think we should define thinking as having two parts, the exploration part where scanning and skimming and browsing and surfing can be very, very important, Googling and everything else. And then there is the time when you stop and you pay attention to what you found and go deep. And I think that what we're doing is redefining as a society intelligence as being all about access and all about finding and all about filtering and all about skimming and scanning. And we're losing sight of the fact that you also have to pull back from the technology, disconnect, and go deep. And obviously there are people who still do that, plenty of people, but I think more and more that's becoming a rare skill. And I think it's the nature of the net, the nature of this medium that encourages us to be constant browsers of information, but never to disconnect in a way that lets us go deep.
I don't know. Seems to me if that's the case, you're doing it wrong.
You're not using it right. Yeah, but
right?
I'm more interested in what's really happening than how people, you know, yeah. I mean, McDonald's has salads and fruit plates. People go in and they buy Big Macs. I mean, it's not that it's impossible, but you have to look at how people actually use it.
Yeah. No, I certainly agree with that there are there are temptations and there's great opportunities, but there's also opportunities for squandering that and making choices that aren't wise. But I guess on you know you have to measure on the whole which way is it going. And to me, I see the benefits more than the negatives. You know, so I look at the people I work with, especially the younger employees, and boy, am I impressed that they're doing far beyond what I was able to do at their age, because they can do so much more. I look at some of the homework assignments. My friend was telling me of the homework assignment his 10-year-old got, which after the Haiti earthquake, they were told, okay, come up with a plan to spend $1 million to help in Haiti. And so these 10-year-olds, fifth graders, I guess, are going out there, and his kid said, okay, I'm going to build schools. And so he researched how much it costs to build a school, how much desks cost. He sourced them out, found a place to buy desks on the web, found a shipping container company, and figured out how many desks fit in the shipping container, got a quote from the shipping container company, and figured out how many schools he could have by building this spreadsheet and multiplying everything out. And that just seemed like a fantastic educational experience, one that you couldn't get from a book, because no books have been written yet about the Haiti earthquake. And so much was done that was facilitated by this online information. And of course, sure, he needed help from his teachers and parents not to be going on Facebook or whatever and to keep on task. But those opportunities are there that are far beyond what we could have done a generation ago.
I think that's right, and I'd be lying if I said I haven't received huge benefits from the web and from the ability to do research much more quickly, to solve problems much more quickly. And there's no doubt for those type of problem-solving exercises, the web can be a huge benefit, and you can do things that were impossible before. And I think that's one of the reasons we use it so much, and particularly one of the reasons it's becoming so ingrained in our work lives, which are often about solving problems, finding particular bits of information. But that's not the only way to think, and it's certainly not the only important way to think. There are also the more attentive, more contemplative ways of thinking that I think are also essential to not solving problems, but expanding our mind, expanding our creativity, expanding our perspective on life. And it's those type of things that are being pushed aside by the web and its many benefits. So, you know, I don't disagree with you that there are ways of being smart and being intelligent that are enhanced by the technology.
Yeah. So you mentioned McDonald's and the, you know, sort of choices there. And, you know, in the 60s, President Johnson declared the war on hunger, and today Michelle Obama has the war on obesity. So we sort of solved one problem. But now it's not the problem of scarcity, it's the problem of abundance that we're dealing with, and the problem of bad choice.
And there's certainly in our web habits, and there's certainly a corollary there, I think, that, you know, there are very deep instincts we have to overvalue new information, particularly if it has some kind of social value. You know, it's very worrisome if you disconnect for a while and think, oh, my friends are saying something, I don't hear it, or there's new information here about something I'm interested in. So I think just as in some ways I suppose the abundance of calories and cheap calories encourages overeating, I think our natural instinct to overvalue the new is fed by the technology, and unfortunately, the expense of overvaluing the new is sometimes we don't spend enough time looking at what's really important. If you have an important piece of information, but you know something new and trivial is coming, you'll often shift your eyes, shift your glance, shift your attention to consume the new stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know if it's the net that contributes to that. I know the net certainly makes the new available. I think it's a pervasive problem in humans, and not just in humans, but in all mammals, that they value the short term over the long term. And George Ansley in the Breakdown of Will says that that's sort of the roots of addiction, is that people say, yes, I see the benefit of taking this alcohol or drugs or whatever right now, and I can kind of discount the long-term negative effects. And you need to be able to have some discipline to get past that, to say, I'm going to think about the long-term in a rational way and not just go for the short-term hits. And so we need those kinds of societal rules. We need the parents saying you can only watch TV or use video games, whatever, for so much time. We need the teachers saying you're not allowed to do this in the bathroom. And even for adults, they need ways to limit their own usage and make good use of the technology.
Unfortunately, we're going in the other direction, however. We're giving ever younger kids cell phones with unlimited text messaging plans. We're putting TVs and computers in their rooms, and we're not supervising them as much. So, I mean, anything we can do to counter those trends, I'm all for, but we still have to pay attention to what's really going on in the fact that it's becoming more and more socially acceptable to be distracted all the time, to talk to your spouse while, you know, glancing at your stream of email on your iPhone or something. I mean, these things, to do it in a restaurant. I mean, these things are becoming accepted in society. So we're not imposing that kind of discipline. And, you know, maybe we will, but I don't see any signs that that's happening. It seems to be going in the other direction.
You know, again, it seems like every generation has its complaints about that, that we're all going to hell in a handbasket, and we have been for every generation. Let's see. I wanted to... I guess in a few minutes we're going to go to the question and answer. We talked about the information overload. We talked about the sort of addiction and irrational behavior and so on. And we talked about reading and deep reading. I guess one thing I wanted to say about that is it seems like sometimes that you're trying to have it two ways. That you're saying the experience you're really aiming for is this deep reading where we're contemplative and reflective and engaging in a deep way. But then you're complaining about the web technology saying that it's changing our brains. And it seems to me it can only change our brains if it's engaging us deeply. Is that a contradiction?
It is kind of a contradiction, but I think there's, as I write in the book, that one of the, probably the most profound characteristic of the net is that it seizes our attention only to shatter it. So we're immersed in the medium itself, very deeply immersed, but what we're immersed in is constant distractions and constant shifts of our attention and shifts of our focus. So it shows you that there are different kinds of immersion, and you can be immersed in a medium without necessarily being attentive to one thing. You can be immersed in the act of being distracted, so to speak. So mm-hmm. I think as we do that, I think that can create those changes in the brain that, you know, it's not mm-hmm. the brain changes that are making us behave that way. We behave that way, and then our brain changes to adapt, so it's a reinforcement mechanism. But I do think that we're immersed in the medium, even as the medium is constantly distracting us.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we're both, in a way, examples and counterexamples to that. So I certainly feel that. I feel distracted, and you've said you have, and yet you were able to put together this book, and it's deep and contemplative, and you did that while you were researching on the web. And I was able to put together my textbook, which, by the way, was six times longer than yours, but... but I don't get a book tour.
Did you have more footnotes?
I don't get a book tour out of it. No. and we were able to do this while researching it on the web. So it is possible to get past those temptations and think deeply and to think much more broadly. You know, so I was able in a couple hours to bring in 20 different friends and have them comment and go back and forth a couple times on what I was thinking and what you were thinking and get some great ideas. I couldn't have done that in that short amount of time without the web technology. Isn't that helping me a great deal?
I'm sure it is. And I'm not, you know, I'm not trying to be overly deterministic about the influence of technology on our brains. The human brain is a wonderful thing, and it's not as though, you know, it's a binary switch and suddenly we turn off our contemplative nature. I do think that these trends we're seeing are very, very important, and I think a lot of people feel it in their own lives that they're not having an opportunity to be attentive and to think deeply, and they're constantly distracted, and I think they feel it for a reason, because it's real. And, you know, it's true that you can still read a book, you can even write a book, although to write mine I had to, you know, pull back from the net quite a bit, and I made an effort to use Google, say, to find information, but then find relevant books, relevant journal articles, but then I actually went to the library and actually got the print material to read, and I found that extremely useful. And I, you know, cut back on email and stuff, and unfortunately I'm drifting in the opposite direction now, but it still, you know, I still had to make some changes, and I could really feel it in my attentiveness, my concentration. But nevertheless, I think we have to take the big picture and look at how, you know, all of us as a society, what direction we're moving in, and whether we still put any value on the more attentive, more contemplative modes of thought, or whether we're giving them up and being pushed in that way by the technology.
Yeah, so I don't see anybody giving them up. I mean, it seems to me that we still value that, and we make it easier to value that in a way, in that it's easier for an individual or a small group of people to get together and do something great if they work hard at it. You know, so we heard earlier today about how a small group put together Facebook. I'm at a company that only 10 years ago came from nothing and now has a big effect on the world. Smaller startups are able to do that. And they're able to do that because of these web technologies. And you can't say that these entrepreneurs are not engaging deeply and working hard and concentrating on what they're doing.
Fair enough.
And I just wanted to, one other, you know, I talked about the emails that came in with suggestions. And one of them was commenting on what a modern idea, this idea of concentration is.
That's absolutely right, which is why it's so precious. Yeah. I mean, it's not our natural way to think. Our natural way to, you know, when we were cavemen or whatever we were, if you concentrated on one thing, you got eaten pretty fast or clubbed on the head or something. So I think that's absolutely right. Our natural inclination is not to pay attention, is to be distracted, is to allow the environment and stimulus and the stimuli in the environment to control our attention. So, yeah, I mean, I think it was the book and other developments that trained us to pay attention. But the fact that that was has been a fairly short part of our history, I mean, doesn't mean we should give it up easily. It means we should cherish it all the more, I think, and protect it all the more.
Yeah, so I'm all for protecting it. And we're going to go to questions in a few minutes. So there's the mic. So if people want to ask questions, please line up there. And while we're doing that, I just wanted to mention one more thing. Which is maybe the book that's closest to yours that's popular now is Clay Shirky's Cognitive Surplus. And he talks about what he calls cognitive surplus is this idea that it's the thing that television stole from us. That in history, for most of history, we had to spend all of our time just sort of surviving. And then in modern society, we got this new notion of leisure time. And that was something that never had existed before. And then television took it away to the tune of 200 billion hours per year in the U.S. alone. And Clay points out that if 1% of the TV watchers throughout the world stopped watching TV and did something useful, that they could produce 2 Wikipedias a week.
Just what we need.
What's your comment on Clay's take?
I think Clay is a very smart guy, and I think he's a very hopeful guy. And if, in fact, we see that change in behavior, that would be a good thing. But what we know from the statistics is that TV viewing hours have gone up throughout the entire era of the web. And in fact, they hit their highest level ever since the Nielsen Company began monitoring TV last year. And if you add to those TV hours, which are now at the highest point ever, all the time we waste online, as opposed to creating Wikipedia and doing other useful things, I think you see that the The time we waste with media today is enormous, and far greater even than in the heyday of television. So, yeah, we might all start changing and start, you know, getting together and creating great things, or we might still continue to waste a lot of time online and TV. I don't know.
Okay. All right, let's go to questions. We'll start from the side.
And these social networks, you have to choose the other thing. You have to choose who not to stay in touch with. And how is that, you know, part of making us smarter, making us dumber, in that conversation, how is staying with the burden of your choices as a young person, is that holding people back? And is that help, is, I went through all these breaks before the internet.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you probably did too. You know, you had to get back, and Facebook got you back in touch.
Okay. Can we get to a question?
Yeah. How do you see that type of thing growing up in a network connected society changing?
Yeah. It's a very good question, and I think for a lot of people, it's entirely a good thing to be able to stay in touch. But I think there are certain people who, as you said, have always throughout history had the possibility to make a clean break and reinvent themselves. And I heard Jerron Lanier recently talk about Bob Dylan when he went from, you know, being Robert Zimmerman in the town in Minnesota, left, totally reinvented himself, became Bob Dylan in New York City, great artist. You know, what would happen today if, you know, Facebook was around, and there's Robert Zimmerman, you know, goofing off in Minnesota, and everybody, when he goes to Greenwich Village, says, oh, you're that guy, you're not Bob Dylan. And so for a certain segment of people, it does lock us into an identity, I think, much earlier than we were ever locked into before. And for those people, which might be just, the great majority of people might not mind being locked into an identity and might like, you know, having perpetual contact with their co-kindergartners or whatever, but I think there is a segment of society that's going to find it much, much tougher, and these might be great artists as well, since they tend to go through this, will find it much tougher to reinvent themselves.
Okay. Now, as a reminder to our audience, this program has been presented by the Commonwealth Club's Inforum Division. Tonight we're hosting Nicholas Carr, author of The Shallows, What the Internet is Doing to Our Brains, and I'm Peter Norvig, Google's Director of Research. Let's go to a question on this side.
Okay, I know from my personal experience that I tend to agree with you. My ability to read a book is diminishing every year. So whereas I could read one a week, now I'm about one a year. So I know that it has happened. One of the things I'd be interested in is your feelings about the future effect of this. I think that you're underestimating the effect. I think it's actually worse because we have an accelerating rate of change in society. So the number of channels that we have to deal with, the number of modes of communication we have to deal with, is continuing to accelerate and change. And so I'm wondering if it'll actually become a worse effect over the next 5 years, 10 years, and so forth.
I'm already kind of pigeonholed as a curmudgeon, so I'm a little nervous about answering that question truthfully, but I think that's right. I mean, I think that we're facing a continuation of this trend. It's true that we all can make personal choices and back away. It's true that we might reinvent the net to be a very different type of technology that encourages concentration. It's true that our employers might say, no, don't stay connected all the time, go away and think for a while. But I think you're right that all the trends in society point to a continued devaluing of that whole way of thinking that doesn't fit into our kind of utilitarian problem-solving mode.
Okay.
I would like to challenge Mr. Norvig a little bit. as much as I admire and respect your research work, I think you made a methodological mistake in your poll, because you missed a sort of large part of the population. I think a different result would come out of this poll if you ask the chairs of universities, of computer science departments at, let's say, California State at Dominguez Hills, or Florida Gulf Coast University, or University of Idaho. I think Google wouldn't hire my students if I told them to get their knowledge from Wikipedia, although it's a very great tool. And finally, I think that we have to take a look at universities which offer degrees online. So and there's many more examples. So I would say that the question, is Google making us stupid, is a valid question, because there is a large segment of population which is just not getting anything out of this. And I have a question to Mr. Carr. You mentioned at the beginning about the probably very first computational machine known to humankind, although you didn't call it that way, which is a clock. And some of these great philosophers like Lewis Mumford or you know, media people like Marshall McLuhan, they recognize the changes which a clock made to, I mean, enforced on us. And they say that we don't eat when we want to eat, but when there's a specific time, we go to work at the same time, not because there's a need to do work, but because there is a time to go to work. And do you see these tendencies with the internet? Because this is what they call a big mega machine, right? And I noticed, well, everybody does this now.
Let's see if we can tackle those two questions. I'll try to go first. I think you raise a good point that technology sort of accelerates differentials, and that elites now can do better, and those who don't have the right education are left farther behind. So there's a bigger gap, and so I sampled one part of that gap and not the other. And that's a very important question for society. I think, and one of the points over here was, well, people aren't reading books anymore. Well, that's somewhat true, but not completely. So Harry Potter sold 400 million copies. The Twilight series, I hate to admit it, sold over 100 million copies. My generation's equivalent to that, which has been selling for 50 years, would be the Narnia books, and that only sold 120 million copies. So I feel so bad, I'm going to go out and buy another whole set. So in general, there is lots of reading going on. Non-required book reading is going down slightly. 61% of people said they read a book for pleasure in 92. It was down to 57% in 2004. Total sales of books are up. Certainly worldwide literacy is down by 50% since the 70s. But that's probably more to do with wealth than with literacy per se or the web. So it's mixed. Magazine readership is way up. Newspapers are down. Reading on the web is up. It's a complicated picture, and there's a lot going on. I think we do have to try to educate everybody, and we have to be creative in the ways that we do that. So sometimes a lecture in the university is not the best way to do that, to have one person sitting in front of the class. You want something a little bit more interactive. And I think we've seen that. There's developments like Salman Khan with Khan Academy. He has 1,500 educational videos online. He gets twice as many students as the University of California as a single person. So there's great opportunities out there, and I think we're at a point where there's a disruptive shift in how we're going to deliver education. And it'll be interesting to see how it plays out. And I think there was a question for Nick in there as well.
Yeah. I think you're absolutely right to point out the fact that any new technology has costs as well as benefits. And when we did begin to parcel out time in little increments, we became more synchronized as a society. We were able to work together better, but we did lose some of our sense of a natural flow of time and how we could live by that flow rather than by the clock. And similar, even with the map. I mean, we almost certainly, as we become more dependent on the map, lose some of our natural navigation sense, and that almost is certainly being amplified now by GPS and stuff like that. And that's not to say that those technologies are bad or that the benefits don't far outweigh the costs, but we do have to realize that whenever we adopt a technology, we're amplifying some part of ourselves, but we're also reducing some of our old skills in handing those over to technology. And so any technology has to be evaluated in that way, I think.
Okay, let's go over here, and let's keep it to one brief question each.
Sure. Nick, it seems like your book is very much focused on the personal choices and the personal effects, but I'm curious about the societal effects. So when we have 1.6 billion people on the internet all behaving in this way, what is going to be the effect on human civilization as a whole? I mean, as Peter mentioned, great companies are still being born, great books are still being written, but what do you see as the broader effects?
That's a big question. You know, I think there are going to be a lot of effects, and some of them, honestly, particularly in the social sphere, are very hard to figure out, and I can't say that I've figured them out. I will say that if you look through the history of culture, you see that many of the great monuments of culture come from people, whether we're talking about science, art, literature, anything, come from people who were able to think attentively and think deeply and be contemplative and be meditative and be reflective. And if we devalue those things and practice those things less, I think we not only become less interesting as individuals, we face a culture that is flatter, and not as vibrant, and again, not as interesting as it used to be.
Okay, so I want to take my prerogative to throw in my answer there as well. And I wanted to quote Stuart Russell, who's the chairman at Berkeley. He was one of my respondents, and he said that students today are like prologue programs with 99% of their clauses missing, or students in the past were like that. Now, what does that mean for you non-programmers out there? So prologue program is a means of doing logical inference by describing what you know and then allowing the program to do very deep inference of combining all those clauses. And what Stuart was saying was in the past, his students could do that, but on only 1% of their subject matter. So they knew very deeply about one thing, and they could reason deeply in that area, and you usually got a thesis out of it. Now he's saying that things have changed, that you can start and not know very much in that area, in an area, and very quickly gather what you need to know and then start doing the deep thinking. And that ability to do the deep thinking was always in the students, but if you didn't have any information about the area, you can't go anywhere with it. So he said that Google encourages mental energy, persistence, and diligence, as well as learning about new things. Okay.
My name is Peter Cicilla. I'll try to be brief. It seems like we're doing a juggling act of priorities towards spending some time dumbing down as a form of entertainment versus smarting up as a form of career and more knowledgeable thinking. My question has to do with the fact that one of the things that I've felt for 30 years for smarting up has been this idea of a National Youth Service Program that was a bill in the Congress. And it was a volunteer basis, but what was unique about it was it would challenge youth to register at 17 and spend a year thinking about what is participatory democracy, and then at 18 indicate an interest in volunteering to do some kind of contracted service. Now, when President Clinton became president, he enacted a program called AmeriCorps and pushed this, and one of the things that I focused on communicating to them was this concept of an information communication computer, the internet. The internet wasn't even a term being used then. But right now, we're in certain economic problems, environmental problems, and to me, this seems to be the balance between challenging youth as they go through the education system to be able to integrate into something in their community that would benefit it. But there seems to be a lot of apathy among the thinkers and the general public.
I'm sure you're right. I mean, I don't have any thoughts on that. Yeah. I mean that sounds
okay.
That sounds right.
Let's try to keep it to questions so we can keep Nick involved.
Professor Google, you mentioned your challenge of juggling so many research projects at the same time. I'm in contact with many computer science students at Stanford, with digital media students at the Academy of Art University. Many feel that Google is overextending itself. What is the current research focus of Google right now?
I mean, I guess the focus is on making information accessible to people. And we see a lot of opportunities. And our biggest cost is opportunity cost for things missed. And so we're going to try to do it. And there's opportunities in multimedia, in mobile, sort of across the board, in deeper semantic processing of text and images and videos and so on. We're looking at all those things, and we're trying to build a system where the infrastructure is such that we can address a new area with a very small team of two or three people. So we can be broad in what we approach because the investments we make in each one is small because all our resources are amortized over all the researchers. That's how we try to approach it.
Can I ask you a question about Google?
Great.
Do you think that universal search, where now we get not only a ranking of what are the best web pages out there, but little images and maybe videos and maybe a stream of tweets. Do you think that's an example of Google dumbing down itself?
No, I don't think so at all. One thing is, you say the internet is so distracting, but we get these criticisms from magazines saying, oh, well, the internet is so limited. It doesn't have the rich images that magazines have. So there are different types of media. I think, McLuhan was wrong. The media is not the message. The message is the message. If the media was the message, then, every year the Academy Awards would end in a tie, would say the Oscar goes to movies. But it doesn't happen that way. Instead, the Oscar goes to the best story, whoever that story is told. And sometimes the story is going to be told as text. Sometimes it's going to be told as a video. Somebody was just telling me earlier today how they were asking a very technical scientific question, and they're expecting to see an article, but instead they got a video lecture from an expert in that area, and it was exactly what they wanted. And if we had made them go to video search, it would never have occurred to them to try video search for that type of a query. But by surfacing it, we gave them what they wanted at the right time.
Hi. I read your article in the Atlantic Monthly, and I have to say, first off, my wife totally agrees with you, and I totally disagree with you. And this is probably
Listen
goes
to your
on
wife.
A lot. And so I have several kids, and I watch them use the internet, and both frivolously watching one YouTube video after another of Family Guy, and also drilling incredibly deep into research for school, and then motivating to get books on the Civil War they never read, and knowing more than I did at their age, and doing it faster. Now, I can't say all kids can do this, but, and some kids probably don't go farther than just watching Family Guy. So, we're dealing with that world of some people are drilling deeper, and it is distracting for others who live at the level of distraction. So my question is it really any different than in 1965 when there was no internet? Aren't the same people not looking deeper, not reading books, doing the same thing now? I mean, they weren't reading great treaties back then,
I don't think so. And that's not to say, kids with the right motivation and the right smarts and stuff aren't going to go deep on the internet. But I don't think that's the way that kids are being pushed by the technology. And in fact, there was a new study that just came out this week, or was just distributed this week, the biggest study yet of what happens when you put computers, personal computers, into kids' homes between the fifth grade and the eighth grade. And that's been a big focus of a lot of public spending to subsidize the purchase of computers. And interestingly enough, their reading and mathematics test scores actually went down rather than up after they got a computer. And it was a small decrease, I mean a very modest decrease, but nevertheless, it really highlights the fact that I think for most kids, it's actually bringing a lot more distractions into their life. It gives them a lot more ways to goof off, and I'm not against kids goofing off, and it also brings distractions into the process of doing homework, doing studying. Fortunately, some kids are able to tune that out, but I think looking broadly, it might be having a very different effect overall.
Well, I have to say one thing. I think that you brought up a good issue that needs to be constantly discussed.
Right? Thank you.
Thanks.
I wanted to throw in one anecdote about distraction, communication, and concentration, and this sort of trade-off between them, which is that at Google every year we have a questionnaire for all our engineers: what do you like and what do you not like about your job? What's bothering you? And last year, the number one question that people liked the most was the quality of their colleagues and the interactions they had with them. And so we thought that was a great result. And the question that they liked the least was being interrupted by other people. So we figured it out that if I can ask anybody a question, but none of them can ask me a question, that we have the perfect situation, but we haven't figured out how to implement that. So I think there's always this trade-off, that you want to have this deep concentration, but communication is important too, because I can't have all the ideas. The one book that I'm reading deeply can't have all the ideas, but communication with lots of people can. And you know, Nick talked about this sort of bucolic retreat into the countryside where you're sitting by the lake and reading the book and everything's peaceful, and that's great. But if you look at where all the big scientific and artistic movements have come out of, well, you know, maybe one for Walden Pond, but against that, you know, it's Paris, it's New York, it's London, it's San Francisco. The cities is where all the action is, and people get past the distraction because they want that communication. Okay, now I get to ask a question, Nick, which is, in 60 seconds, what is your one idea for how to change the world?
The embarrassing thing here is I was prepped for this question. I think I'm sure there are bigger ideas than this, but just to stick with the subject, I would hope that, even though I don't see this in purely generational terms, I would hope that parents begin to realize that handing your kids, constantly inundating them with new technologies and giving them a motivation to be interrupted all the time and to inundate themselves with information has to be balanced by encouraging them to be attentive, to read, to back away from the technology, even to back away from their friends sometimes. And as you said, collaboration and conversation is great, but there's also a role in the world for solitude. And I think we should encourage our kids and ourselves to practice that as well.
Okay. So thank you to Nicholas Carr for sharing your insight and vision with us tonight. This meeting of InForum and the Commonwealth Club is now adjourned.